Hi all, in this video, let's explore some of the points which are needed as a JavaScript developer. So we'll start with the difference between the dot notation and the bracket notation, when to use what, and about the anonymous functions, and how to test the responsiveness of a website. So let's start. So the first point is, what's the difference between a dot notation and the bracket notation? So if we consider this as a sample object, so the dot notation means like this, the object dot name. So this is how the dot notation works. And to access this value, we need to use like object dot name. This is a dot notation. Coming to the bracket notation, object, we need to use a bracket and a single quote or double quote to represent the property name, key name. And this is the way we access the value. So this is a sample example of how the dot notation and the bracket notation looks. So we need to understand blindly, we need to use the dot notation whenever needed because it is simple to use. But before that, we need to understand the limitations of this dot notation so that exactly we can know when to use this bracket notation. So the first limitation of this dot notation is if you have an object like this and the keys of this object are invalid identifiers, in sense, an identifier will not start with the digits. So that's one point. So in these cases, the invalid identifiers, in the case, in such a case, like if you have an object with invalid identifiers, then if you use dot operator, we'll get into syntactical errors. Like we have certain properties in this object. So if you try to access these properties with this object, you'll be getting the syntactical errors like this because object.123, because this is not a valid identifier, we'll be getting an error like this. This is also not a valid identifier. So all, upon all these things, so the letter can start with a dollar. So that's the reason this is a valid one. And in all these cases, you can identify a common mistake is like if a identifier starts, if we have an invalid identifier in the object, it's bad and we'll be getting into trouble if we use the dot notation. So whereas in these cases, the bracket notation helps us a lot. You can understand here the same. We are trying to use a bracket notation with the double quotes here. So now you can extract the value of the key. There won't be any issues if you use the bracket notation. So the first limitations of the dot notation is if you have any invalid identifier in your object, then it's better to go with the bracket notation. So that's the first limitation. Coming to the second one is accessing of the variables as a property. For example, consider this as a variable and this is an object. So if you use object variable, so this variable is the variable name. While you are using the variable name, don't keep the double quotes or single quotes. Don't make this as a string. You should do this only to access the key. You need to keep the double quotation or the single quotation only for the object keys. But for the variables directly, you need to use without the quotations. So now it is saying that in this variable would be replaced with this single quote name. So in sense object of single quote name, you'll be getting the value like this. So this is about the bracket notation. When you're trying to use the same variable with object dot variable, we'll be getting undefined. The reason behind this is variable is not a property of this object. That's the reason we can't access this variable, we'll be getting an undefined. So with this knowledge, we'll try to sort out this one. So this is the variable name and you have an object with the same variable property. So then what happens if you're trying to access the object of variable? It will give the object of variable, means in this variable, you'll be having this double quote name. It means object of double quote name is value. You'll be getting this one. This is a small type of knowledge testing. So you'll be getting a value like this here. So if you access object dot variable, you'll be getting this one. So this is one of the interesting question we used to get. If you understand the dot notation and the bracket notation exactly, we can answer these questions exactly. So this is all about the dot notation and the bracket notation. So coming to the second point, what is an anonymous function? A function which will not have a name is called as anonymous function. So in this function, you have the name as sum. This is a function, and you have the name of this function is sum. Whereas, what is mean by anonymous function means you will be having a function like this, and you will not have any name to that function. So find how to access this function. Yep. We can keep this, assign this function to any of the variable. So I am assigning this function to this variable. I am consoling that some value. So this is how you can assign a anonymous function to a variable, and you can call this function like this. So this is how you need to call your function. So this is the first example of our anonymous function. So let's see what all the use cases of this anonymous functions. In most of the cases, we'll be writing set time interval in our applications. So you'll be having a callback function. So to this callback function, you will not write any of the name of the function. So you'll be giving like this, and the name, the second parameter would be like 2000 milliseconds, like 2 seconds. So now in this type of things also, you will be, this is a set timeout function. In this time here, you will be taking the callback function. Now, if you observe, you have taken a callback function, and for this function also, there is no name. In this is also an anonymous function. We'll be using this, but we don't know exactly. This is an anonymous function. So this is the second example of this anonymous function. Coming to the third example, like in some cases, you wanted to write some piece of code in the function, and you wanted to execute it with a self. No one needs to call it. It can call itself, and it needs to execute that piece of code. It means like self-executing function. So how to write that self-executing function? So I wrote a function. We'll be writing this. So something will be there. Some code will be there in this function. So fine. So how to execute this code as a self-executing function? It means you need to cover up this with a bracket, and now you need to call it up. So as soon as it comes, you are calling this function. It means it is a self-executing. It means we are immediately calling, invoking this function. So this is also an best example of anonymous function. So finally, where exactly we can use this means on all these above cases, we can use this one can be also called as function expression. So this is for the callback function, and this is self-executing function. So in the third case, if you have a button, so I have a button. So you want to add some event to that button. So in that case, document.getElementById. So you'll be using that some ID you will be having in your HTML. Assume that you will be having some ID in your HTML. Say that is button. So now you want to add some event to this button. So in that case also, you can use this button dot on click. So I'm writing one event, and now you can assign this function without any name. So whoever clicks this button, this event would be triggered, and this anonymous function would be executed. So this one is also an best example of discussing about the anonymous function. These are the four best example to define or the use cases of the anonymous functions. So adding an event to the buttons or any of the elements of the HTML page. So this is all about what is an anonymous function. I think we can explain. You can explain with these examples. So coming to the third one, how to test the responsiveness of the web application. So usually, so let me take one website. So you have a website here. So if you want to test the responsiveness, what does the responsiveness exactly mean? So the website should be visible. It should be a clear appearance in all the major devices. So that is about the responsiveness. So how to test this responsiveness? So usually what we do is we'll right click, inspect. It means we are trying to open the developer tools. And here, if you observe, you will be having an icon like this. So this is a device toggle icon. If you click this, you'll be having an N number of options to test the responsive design. So this is iPhone X. Now we are testing. So we are testing this website in the iPhone. If anyone opens this website in the iPhone, he would be looked in this way. Yeah, he can see the website like this. So you can also modify accordingly. In the Moto G, it would be look like this. So in this case, in this way, you can test your responsive design. But by testing these type of responsive, you need to check to the specific devices. So I have explored an, a better option than this, so which I'm using in my project. So that is go to the Chrome Web Store and type responsive viewer. So this is the extension, responsive viewer, the Chrome extension. You can add this Chrome extension to your browser and restart your browser so that you will be, let me show you that. So if you restart it and just, you'll be getting an icon like this here at the top. You can ping this Chrome extension. And if you click the website, so you can go to any of the web pages like this. Let me show you it once again. I'm going to this web page. And if you want to test the responsive design of this web page, so here you will be having an icon. If you click this, you'll be getting a view like this. So it means you can test the website in all the major devices. In our terms, you can test the website in the major breakpoints. So now you can sync the scrolling. You need to enable this to sync the scrolling. In sense, if you scroll in all the devices, it would be scrolled at the same time. And also you can sync the text as well. If you click any of the link, all the links in all the pages would be referred. So in this way, this is a better way to test the responsive web design so that you can save a lot more time. You can add more devices and more related breakpoints. I'm adding the large screen as well. You need to scroll down here. So here you will be getting the large screen as well. See, here you have the large screen. In this way, you can add a number of devices and you can test them like this. So I'm testing all the designs in one go. You can keep side by side and you can test the major devices like medium. So this would be the major breakpoint. And for the mobiles, this would be the major breakpoint. If you get any issue, you can take a screenshot here. You can capture it and you can assign that to the developers, or you can, if you are the developer, then you can keep the better breakpoints, not to break the thing at this breakpoint, not to break the website at that breakpoint. So this is how it's a best idea to test the responsive web design. So the extension name is responsive viewer. So hope you understand the video. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for the more video.